Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. All praise is due to Allah alone. We all praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is the truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show Him guidance. May the greatest peace and salutations be upon Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. My dear viewers, welcome to another live edition of Ask Huda. And this episode, we're going live outdoor since we're filming an amazing program, mashallah. The program is called How He Treated Them. How did Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam treated various kind of people? It's going to be an amazing program, inshallah. Sheikh Ibrahim Zidane, Sheikh Wasim Kamson, Dr. Muhammad Saeed, and myself, inshallah, will be partaking in filming this program. So our phone number should appear on the bottom of the screen. Should you have any question, please feel free to dial any of the following numbers, and we'll take it from there, inshallah. Saeed from Kenya is our first caller today. Saeed, assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Ask Huda, Saeed.
Alaikum salam.
Go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, I hear you, Saeed. Go ahead. Bismillah. What is your question, Akhi?
Okay. What is the authentic dua for entering the toilet and coming out of the toilet?
Jazakallah khairan. Thank you, Saeed. Our most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us that the places for answering the calls of nature are being inhabited by the jinn. So in order to protect yourself while entering any of these places, or if it is in an open place, you should say أعوذ بك من الخبث والخبائث. So you seek refuge with Allah against الخبث والخبائث. The word khubth and khaba'ith refers to the muscular and the feminine of the jinn, males and the females of the jinn. And you walk in with the left foot, and when you finish and you're relieved, you step out to the right foot and you say ghufranak, you seek Allah's forgiveness. We as Muslims, as believers in the oneness of Allah, we turn every habit, every daily routine into an act of worship where we'll be rewarded for it. As a matter of fact, once a Jew said to Salman al-Farisi, may Allah be pleased with him, that your religion is intervening in everything, is talking about everything. He said, yes indeed, even answering the call of nature. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us as Muslims how to answer the call of nature, what dua to recite before and after you relieve yourself, and how to remove the impurities after doing number one and number two in order to purify yourself to get ready for the prayer. Thank you, Saeed from Kenya. Assalamu alaikum. Tasneem from Bangladesh. Welcome to Ask Huda, sister Tasneem. Assalamu alaikum. That's Tasneem, brother Tasneem. Yeah, go ahead, Tasneem.
My question is, one of my close relatives just invited me for his son's birthday. Mm-hmm. He didn't mention that it's a birthday party, but I know that the occasion is for birthday. And if I don't go there, they will like be very sad. So what should I do? I'm like in a situation, my mom is insisting me to go there. They are saying that it's just the occasion of having good food in his son's birthday. Now I am in a dilemma that what should I do? I can reject and I can accept also. What should I do, Sheikh?
I never feel myself in dilemma whenever I'm invited to anything which I believe it is not something right to do. So we say that the concept of birthday celebrations is totally non-Islamic. It has been practiced by non-Muslims, particularly Christians. And our most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whose birth was the most valuable, no doubt, and then afterward his companions, did not have this tradition. So those who insist on imitating the Western cultures and throwing the birthday parties and singing the same song and so on, they're free to do so. No one would object to them. But as a practicing Muslim, I do my best to stick to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I would not feel any bad, or I would not feel in a dilemma to say, I'm sorry, I won't be able to attend. So wishing somebody a happy occasion, including birthday, it's okay, but I'm not going to attend such party. Thank you, Tasneem from Bangladesh. Barakallah fikum. Sister Aisha from India, welcome to Ask with us, Sister Aisha.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I just have a question, like, for example, I just wanted to know where I can draw the line between being a disobedient and disrespectful wife, because sometimes when I'm in the kitchen or doing some work and my husband calls me, my baby drops a piece of food or something like that, and I expect him to pick that up by himself. For a very small thing he calls, and I'm saying I'm in the middle of some work, he says I'm being disrespectful and not being obedient. For example, I'm mopping the floor or something like that. When he calls me, I say I'm in the middle of some work. He's saying I need to answer him at that point of time. So I tell him, why don't you do small things by yourself? For example, baby dropping some food, he can pick that up by himself. And but then he says, Allah did not say you have to only answer your husband for major things. But then even for smallest call, you have to answer. So I just wanted to know if I'm being disrespectful and disobedient. So I just wanted a little clarification on the Sheikh.
Thank you, Sister Aisha from India. The most beautiful reference in this respect is what Allah the Almighty said in Surah Al-Baqarah, where He said, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. So the ayah that talks about that women, men and women, have equal rights and duties. So it's mutual between both of them. There must be mutual respect, considering the rights of others as much as I consider the rights of myself. In other words, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith, if a woman offers her 5 daily prayers and she fasts during the month of Ramadan, and then she obeys her husband and guard her chastity, it will be said to her on the Day of Judgment, enter paradise from whichever gate you desire, from whichever gate you choose. Al-Jannah have 8 gates. Such a noble entry. And what do? Offer the 5 daily prayers, fast during Ramadan, guard your chastity, and obey the husband. This obedience is not like an obedience of a servant to God or a servant to master. It is an obedience of doing what? Of cooperating, helping one another, assisting each other. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَإِنَّهُنَّ عَوَانٌ عِنْدَكُمْ. He said, إِسْتَوْصُوا بِالنِّسَاءِ خَيْرًا. If the Almighty Allah Himself said, if dinner is served while it is Isha prayer, begin by eating dinner, then offer your Isha prayer. And this is a meeting with God, because first thing comes first. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah does not ask anyone to do anything beyond their capacity. So if I'm tied up with some work and I wasn't able to pick up the phone or answer immediately, as a husband, as a friend, as a mother, as a son, as any person who's calling another, even an employer calling his employee, should give him or her the benefit of doubt. Okay? A smart wife would answer and say, honey, I will answer you in a minute. I'm tied up with some business. My hands are wet, or I'm cooking, in order to diffuse the problem before taking place. May the Almighty Allah bring peace, tranquility, love and affection to both of you, Sister Aisha. Assalamu alaikum. Ahmed from Uzbekistan, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah, dear Sheikh.
Ahlan wa sahlan, Ahmed. Welcome to Ask Wada. Go ahead.
Sheikh, if it is possible, I have 2 questions.
Go ahead.
The first one is about Holy Quran. It is said in Holy Quran that Allah created the earth in certain days in 2 days and mountains in 4 days and so on. No. As we know and have iman that Almighty Allah is capable of creating everything in a moment. He says be and it will be. why Allah mentions certain days in this? Is there a lesson for us to learn from this ayah that He created this earth in certain days?
Jazakallahu khair.
My second question.
Nah.
Second question is about Maulid Nabawi. In my country, people are divided into two groups. The first group says it is sin, bid'ah, to celebrate Maulid, and other group says it's okay. This is my second question.
طيب, thank you, brother Ahmed, I believe. Jazakallahu khairan. The ayah which talks about the detailed explanation of how many days the creation of the heavens and the earth have taken is in Surah Fussilat, which means explained in details. Then finally Allah says, ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَسَوَّهُنَّ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ. Then He rose above the heavens and He made them, perfected them as seven heavens. Your question makes sense. Allah the Almighty in other ayat says, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَن يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Whenever Allah wants anything to take place, He simply commands it by saying to it, be, and it is. So in the creation of the heavens and the earth in 6 days, and explaining how Allah the Almighty perfected everything in earth and on earth, and likewise in the heavens, some of the commentators of the Quran say, there are many, saying that Allah the Almighty is teaching us perfection. Otherwise, the creation of anything like the creation of the angels and the creation of Al-Jannah, the creation of Al-Nar, the creation of Al-Arsh, all of that has been all created by Kun, Fayakun, the creation of the Jinn. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decorates, beautifies and perfects the heavens and the earth, each creation takes a couple days and the total sum is 6 days. For this purpose, to take your time to perfect what you do. But indeed, He is able to do all things by simply saying to it, kun, be, and it is immediately. The milad of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's all agree that we all love and should love Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than anything else, including our own selves. Our parents, our family members, our loved spouses and children, our wealth and position. In the sound hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من نفسه وماله وولده والناس أجمعين. No one will be a perfect and a true believer unless and until I become dearer to him than himself, than his family, than his business and position, and than all people. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam should be your most beloved. Then you are a true believer. As it's also stated in other ahadith narrated by Anas ibn Malik, that ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ وَجَدَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. There are three traits, whoever will possess them will find the sweetness of Iman. One of them is to have Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam dearer to you than anything else. Accordingly, to express this love, we need to look into a couple things. Who loved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam a great deal and before us? Obviously, his companions, then at-tabi'een, then the followers of at-tabi'een. And this is exactly what Allah have listed in the Quran and what the Prophet ﷺ has stated. خَيْرُ النَّاسِ قَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. The best of people in this ummah are my companions, then the following generation at tabi'in, then the following generations, the tabi'i at tabi'in. Three generations. Not a single time any of the sahaba like Abu Bakr, or Umar, or Uthman, or 124,000 companions who have performed Hajj, the farewell Hajj, along with the Prophet ﷺ, was ever reported as throwing party to celebrate the birth of the Prophet ﷺ, or his birth, or the birth of anyone. Fact number one. Fact number two, historians are not in an agreement as to what is the date of the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We know for certain that he was born on Monday. And according to the vast majority of the historians and the books of Siyar, he was born in the month of Rabi'ul Awwal. Some claim that Ramadan, but according to the more correct view, and this is the view of the vast majority of the scholars, in the month of Rabi'ul Awwal. But as for the date, the 2nd, the 8th, the 9th, the 12th, these are all different opinions. And guess what? Historians prefer the 9th as it consigns Monday. And that's another proof that it wasn't something known to the Prophet, to his companions, to the following generations. And who started this tradition? The Fatimites, the extreme Shias, who actually deviated entirely from the deen of Allah. They did not only celebrate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they celebrated the birth and the death of everyone of Ahlul Bayt al-Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whom we know of and whom we have no idea about. In order to keep the Ummah busy with these celebrations, even though they were not practicing the deen. I'll tell you how I, Muhammad Salah, like to celebrate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yesterday, it was Friday, and I gave a khutbah about the commemoration of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So studying his seerah, reviving the love of the Prophet in the hearts and the minds of my children, my family members, and my students, the viewers and the community is a praiseworthy act. Even if I do it nowadays during this time to remind the audience. Then, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because he frequently fasted on Mondays and Thursdays, he was asked, why these 2 days? And why he recommended them? He said, for Monday, that's a day on which I was born. And I received the wahi, the risala, I was commissioned with the prophethood on Monday. So I fast on that day to give thanks to Allah. I like to do the same as Muhammad Salah. I celebrate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam every Monday, not only once a year. Because what the historians have agreed to, that the 12th of Rabi'ul Awwal is the date of his death, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But they have not agreed to the date of his birth. Finally, ayah number 31, chapter number 3, Surah Al-Imran, Allah the Almighty says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَّحِيمٌ. And it means, say, if you truly love Allah, then follow me, follow Prophet Muhammad. If you do, Allah will love you and will forgive you your sins. Indeed, Allah is the oft forgiving, the most merciful. Having said so, do not be harsh on anyone who insists on celebrating the Mawlid, throwing party and distributing the sweets and gathering the family members and serving food. May Allah bless them. But you know what is best. You know how to celebrate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam best according to the Sunnah. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Ishaq from India. Welcome to Ask Huda, Ishaq.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Ahlan wa sahlan. Welcome to the program. Go ahead.
My question is that when looking for a spouse, when the families exchange details, they talk about the educational qualifications. MashaAllah, nowadays they also talk about the Islamic education. So is it okay to disclose or to say, that, yeah, we've been reading books of fiqh, tafsir, etc., or is it considered to be exposing or boasting about your good deeds, or should we remain silent, or is it okay to say what we say about the good that we do?
It is actually perfectly okay, my brother Ishaq, and once again, it's all about the niyyah, your intention. I'm not saying that to show off, I'm introducing myself. When I apply for a job, they ask me for what I do best, my qualifications, my degrees and credentials. So I show them everything. I throw the book at them. So I'm proposing to a girl. I want to make sure that she's on the same page. this is what I like to read. I'm not into reading Harry Potter. Rather, I read the tafsir of Ibn Kathir. I study this, I do that. Would you like to join me? So from the beginning, we want to make sure that there's chemistry and compatibility. So if this is your niyyah, perfect. And also in other cases, you want to tempt colleagues, co-workers. You want to invite them to read like yourself. So you say, yesterday I was reading in the book of tafsir and I loved it. I came across this meaning. So basically you're saying it in order to encourage them to imitate you. That is permissible. Not only permissible, you will receive a reward similar to everyone who would follow your guidance, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Abdul Basit from Zambia. As a matter of fact, I see messages that no one is picking. All our phone lines are working. Alhamdulillah wa shukrillah. I mean by that the WhatsApp numbers, and they will be displayed on the bottom of the screen. May I request the director to keep the two numbers, the two WhatsApp numbers displayed all the time? I would appreciate that. These are the two numbers. Of course, I don't have a screen in front of me, but I guess they are on the bottom of the screen. So dial any of the following number, WhatsApp calls only. Barakallahu feekum. Abdul Basit from Zambia. Assalamu alaikum, Abdul Basit. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the program, akhi. Go ahead.
Okay. Sheikh, I've got a question. The people who go to Jannah have read me. Does that mean that they have already been judged before undergoing the test?
Unfortunately, your question is not clear. I can barely hear you. But let's take Imran, and for Sister Samra Amir, who says that the lines are always engaged non-stop. By the grace of Allah, we receive hundreds of calls during the live show. And this is a blessing from Allah. We do our best to entertain as many calls as possible. Assalamu alaikum. Imran from Canada. Assalamu alaikum, Imran.
Assalamu alaikum wa barakatuh, Sheikh. Jazakallah khair for your assistance and time. I pray that Allah blesses you immensely and rewards you immensely for this. My question for today would be, originally I'm from Bangladesh, and in Bangladesh we have a tendency for burying the umbilical cord of a newborn child at specific locations. We have a concept of either burying that in a university so that, you know, for some reason knowledge can be attained or a blessing can be attained from that. Some people do it at the outside of the masjid and whatnot. Is there a specific sound hadith which actually tells us what to do with the umbilical cord of the newborn child?
Well, the first segment where you said that we bury the umbilical cord, this is praiseworthy act. The rest is something completely false and it should not be observed. Assuming that burying the umbilical cord at a certain place, whether in front of a masjid or at a certain place, will bring a blessing to anyone, this is absolutely a myth, okay, and superstition. So this is not permissible. You guys, whenever you collect this, the nurse will take it and dispose it or bury it anywhere, not assuming that the burial place will be a cause of blessing, neither for the baby or the parents or anyone. Thank you, Imran from Canada. Assalamu alaikum. Our sister Samra from Canada, you're on the line already, Sister Samra. MashaAllah, go ahead.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam.
I have a very quick question.
Yeah.
If the Netflix spice, is it halal for us? Because in lot of Pakistani and Indian cuisines, we add this nutmeg, and I've heard that it is not halal. And if it's halal, how much quantity can we use in our dishes?
No. That's it. Any other questions?
Look,
Sister Samra, no one doesn't like the Pakistani food. You guys, your food is not just delicious, it's amazing. We feel like, you know, you don't want to finish. And obviously, the, you know, the condiments that you use are very special. MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. But nutmeg, most of the scholars said it's not permissible because it is classified as some sort of intoxicant if it is being used or consumed with a large quantity. And the fiqh rule says, مَا أَسْكَرَ كَثِيرُهُ فَقَلِيلُهُ حَرَامٌ. If anything that is being consumed in a large quantity that causes a person to be intoxicated, then a small quantity out of it is forbidden as well. I'm sure that you're not going to run out of spices and condiments, so avoid the nutmeg, please, Sister Samra. Thank you. So, brothers and sisters, it's time to take a break, and inshallah, we'll be back in a few minutes. Please stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to the second segment of today's program, Ask Huda. And our phone numbers, which are only two numbers for the day, the WhatsApp numbers should appear on the bottom of the screen. If you have any questions, do not hesitate to dial any of the following numbers which you see on the screen. Dantu from Gambia, assalamu alaikum Dantu, welcome to Ask Huda.
Walaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sheikh, how are you doing?
Great, alhamdulillah. How can I help you, Dantu? Dantu, can you hear me?
Hello, Sheikh, can you get me?
Yes, go ahead. What is your question, Dantu?
Yes, actually, I want to ask with regards to Salah. Yeah, let's say like I miss three rakah, so I join in the, let's say, Isha prayer. I join Imam in the final rakah. Mm. So when the Imam do taslim, working, getting off from sitting down towards the two up, do I have to say Allahu Akbar? Because I heard someone saying like you don't need to say that one since that one was covered when you are sitting with the Imam.
Okay.
So I don't know whether can you clarify this question for me?
Got your question. Dantu's question is concerning a masala which is known as Salatul Masbuq. If somebody comes late to a congregational prayer, what he should do? Like he attended the prayer at the second or the third rak'ah, so it remains for him to stay one rak'ah or two rak'ahs. Fact number one, without any imam or a follower, in every takbir you must make it on your own, and tasmi'a likewise. It's not because you are a follower in the congregational prayer, you don't say Allahu Akbar. No, you make it. Whether the beginning takbir or what is known as the moving takbirs from one position to another, going for bound down, rising up from ruku', you say Sami' Allahu liman hamida, going for prostration, you say likewise, sitting up, you say likewise. Then when the Imam finishes his sit of four rak'ahs, if remains for you one or two units, Allahu Akbar, and you resume as this is your third or fourth rak'ah exactly. Since in the sound hadith which is collected by Imam Bukhari, Prophet Muhammad, may peace and blessings be upon him, said, فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُّوا. Whatever you catch with the Imam, join in any position. And then after he finishes, resume فَأَتِمُّوا, not make up. Thank you, Dantu from Gambia. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Namir from Oman. Assalamu alaikum, Namir.
Wa alaikum assalam. How are you?
I'm doing great, alhamdulillah. Welcome to Ask Huda. How can I help you, Namir?
Yes, Sorry, I'm a bit starstruck right now. I'm so happy to call you, but I wanted to ask you a couple of questions. I'll try to keep it short.
Sure.
The one thing I wanted to ask, primarily living in Oman, most of the people over here, they're Ibadi.
Mm.
And I want to know what's the ruling behind praying behind them in congregation.
Okay.
Because I cannot select the mosques. And
second question.
Hello?
Yes. What is your second question?
Yes, I wanted to ask what's the... Yes, I wanted to ask, what is the sunnah way of praying behind the congregation in Asr and Zuhr, like the first rak'ah and the second rak'ah, if the imam doesn't give you time to say the Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, the Surah Al-Fatiha?
Okay.
Do I recite it anyway, even if, what you call it, in Maghrib and Asr prayer, if they do not give me time to recite it?
Yeah, let me...
Do I recite it anyway?
Let me begin by answering your second question. If a follower is praying in a congregational prayer and the imam is super fast to the extent that I cannot even recite Al-Fatiha or even half of it, then say goodbye to the imam and resume on your own, because his super fast prayer will make his prayer actually invalid, inappropriate. I'm saying if it is to the extent that no one is able to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, okay? There are some people like that. They are on a hurry. When they say Allahu Akbar for ruku', by the time you make ruku', they're already rising up. So goodbye. Continue on your own. May Allah bless you. A follower, as well as an imam, should recite Surah Al-Fatiha in every single unit of the prayer, whether in the loud prayer or in the not loud prayer, whether the remaining two rak'ahs of Isha or one rak'ah of Maghrib, or the entire number of rak'ahs of Asr and Dhuhr, obviously. So everyone should recite Fatiha on own. If you're a kind of person who recites slowly, please move forward if you're praying in Jama'ah to join the flow. Okay? If you make if the Imam makes ruku' and you're still having غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ, finish it up and join the Imam in the last part of ruku'. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from our prayers. And brothers and sisters, whether you are an imam or a follower, remember that the messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, saw somebody in the masjid praying. And he finished and he came and he said salam to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Said, "Irji' fa salli fa innaka lam tusalli." Go back. Redo your prayer. You haven't prayed yet. So he went and he did the same thing. And he was so quick, super fast. And he came to greet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and chat with him. He said, "Arji' fa salli fa innaka lam tusalli." Go back and pray again. He haven't prayed yet. And that indicates the speed in the prayer invalidated his prayer. After three times he said, "I swear to the one who sent you the truth, I do not know how to do any better." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught him to be khashi'a and acquire tranquility in the prayer, in the standing position, in the ruku' position, in bound down, in the prostration, okay? Not to make it like the picking of a rooster super fast. That invalidates the prayer. Your first question. It is true that Al-Ibadiyya is classified as a sect of Khawarij, okay? And I'm not sure whether today's Ibadis follow the same belief, where they judge a person who commits a major sin of being an unbeliever, etc., etc. And there are certain things which are clear violation to the concept of aqidah, to the mainstream of the ummah. If this is the case, obviously I cannot pray behind them. I know Omanis, and I've been there, but I did not investigate that. They are super nice people. You can say, subhanallah, they are the nicest in the entire Gulf area. But that would require certain investigation to realize and to find out about the akhi. Thank you so much. Numer from Oman. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Shuaib from Pakistan. Welcome to Ask Hudaya, Shuaib.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, akhi. Go ahead.
Sheikh, if I just have two questions, if you can help me. My first question is, who is better, a student of knowledge who spends hours learning memorization and he might have very less time to socialize with people, but there are layman Muslims who try to stay away from sins, they stick to the basics, and they help people, they visit the sick, they give charity, and they do, they meet the family members. And Muslims, they don't even know terms like, you know, Ashari, Maturidi, they don't read many books. They stick to the basics. They might not have many knowledge about fiqh, like the old generation. Like I remember my old, you know, my grandfather.
But Shuaib,
he might not have information like I do.
May
due
I
to
interrupt
YouTube.
You for a moment, Shuaib? Can you hear me? Shuaib. Assalamu alaikum.
Yes, Sheikh.
Yeah, what prevents a person from being both? From being a seeker of knowledge and a social person, a person who learns and a person who gives da'wah. Zakah of knowledge is to share it with others. Ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy on him, said, a Muslim who socializes with people and he bears with them patiently and he tolerates their harms and their ignorance and negligence is better than a Muslim who isolates himself from them. What benefit a person would benefit if he keeps seeking knowledge and he doesn't share this knowledge with others? You know, one of the greatest means of steadfastness on the straight path, obviously, is seeking knowledge, but greater than that is giving da'wah. So socializing with people, sharing with them what is good, this is what Allah the Almighty said, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ, and they enjoin one another to the truth, and they enjoin one another to patience. Such people are not among the losers. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. And that's why, definitely, it is best to be both. And when you deal with the layman and share with them Islamic informations, I would recommend that you open up subjects for them like Ash'aris and Maturidis and Salafis and this and this and that, because ordinary people want to learn where is Allah, how to worship Allah in simple way. So introduce Islam to them as beginners, as new Muslims, without teaching them a class of comparative fiqh or the differences in the madhahib and the different sects and groups and so on, because they are ordinary people. Maybe they cannot afford the knowledge that you have obtained. Jazakallahu khairan, Shuaib. Keep up doing the good work. May Allah bless you and your family. Assalamu alaikum. Abdul Musawir from Germany. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Ask Huda. Naam, go ahead, akhi.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sheikh.
Yes, I hear you. What is your question?
I have two questions.
Yeah.
The first one is when you take someone to buy some to shopping or like this, and he buy like alcohol or pig, and you take him with your car for shopping, and he is not Muslim and he buy alcohol or pig, and you take him back to home. It is allowed to shopping with such a person?
My respected brother, thank you for asking this question. If I'm a cab driver, I'm an Uber captain, and I do not know what this person is shopping or carrying in his bag, I don't care, even if he's carrying alcohol. When a colleague or a friend of mine says, Abdul Musawar, can you take me to the grocery store because I need to buy a liquor or beer? I would say no. Why not? Because in Islam, ayah number 2, chapter number 5, Surah Al-Ma'idah, the Almighty Allah says, وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. You should not help nor assist each other in committing sins or any form of transgression. If this is haram, don't be a part of it. Thank you. Abu Musawar from Germany. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sidi from Germany. Assalamu alaikum.
Hello, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Hello?
Yeah, I hear you, Sidi. Go ahead. What is your question, brother?
Okay, now I can hear you. Sheikh, how are you?
I'm doing great, alhamdulillah.
Okay, assalamu alaikum, Sheikh, how are you?
Wa alaikum salam. Just say your question, please.
Sheikh, my question is, can I pray with my brothers at home when I can't pray Jumu'ah at the mosque because of work or because of school?
Can you pray with your brothers at home if you cannot pray Jumu'ah in the masjid? Isn't this your question? Look, Akhi, when the scholar said it's permissible for a Muslim to live in a non-Muslim society for certain reasons, provided he can observe his Islamic duties, his religious duties. If a person skips 1, 2, 3, and 4 Jumu'ahs, Allah will put a seal on his heart. It is one of the most devastating sins to skip the Jumu'ah prayer. Allah revealed an entire surah in the Quran called Surah Al-Jumu'ah. And in it he said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمُعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. So Allah has ordained on all the believers on Friday, whenever it is Friday prayer, you suspend everything, you leave everything in hand, school, business, unless if it is something emergency, a heart surgeon, an anesthesiologist in the operating room, or a patient is undergoing a surgery. But attending classes, going to work, that is not an excuse to skip the Jumu'ah prayer. You take off for 1 hour to attend the Jumu'ah prayer in the nearest masjid. Thank you, Sidi from Germany. Assalamu alaikum. Muhammad from Brunei. Assalamu alaikum, Muhammad.
Hello. Yeah, I'm Muhammad from Brunei.
Yeah. Welcome to Ask Oda. How can I help you?
Sheikh, I have my question. I have a Facebook group. Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
I have a Facebook group of 100,000 people. I'm very passionate about doing dawah and helping people out. But the thing is that whenever I'm confronted with a question, right, Sheikh, I try to find answers online because there are new reverts who sometimes come to the fold of religion of Islam. They have no Islamic community or any masjid nearby them. So they find Facebook group, they ask their questions to us. So I try to find all the resources referring to your questions, referring to Islam Q&A, and I try to give them answers to their questions. If that's the right procedure.
Yeah, of course. This is great. This is great. And never be tempted to answer questions. Never be tempted to answer questions that you do not know the real answer. So in many cases, I don't mind searching for an answer and sending the questioner the answer as is, maybe in Islam Q&A, maybe Islam Web, maybe different resources, the comprehensive library, the Council of Fatwa in Europe, in the USA, AMJA. Okay, where do I get my information from? Yes, I studied at Al-Azhar. I graduated master's, PhD, fiqh, comparative fiqh, all of that. But that doesn't give me an access to know everything. In many cases, in this program, I say, I don't know. I'll find out. I'll get back to you next episode. And the Prophet ﷺ himself did so. And obviously the companions and the great scholars, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik, was asked so many questions. I said, I don't know. Because I don't know. So do not hesitate to refer them. If you can fetch the answer from any of these websites, Huda TV, AMJA, Islam Q&A, Islam Web, and post it to the questioner, Jazakallahu khayran. Allah will reward you an immense reward. Addallu ala al-khayri kafa'ila. Barakallahu feek. Assalamu alaikum. Abdullah from Sierra Leone. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Guess what? You're the last caller for the day, inshallah. So hurry up. What is your question, Abdullah?
Yes, my question now, the first question that I have is concerning about dreams. You understand how Islam say about dreams? If you sleep, you have good dream or bad dream.
Got your question. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whatever you see of good dreams is from Allah. And whatever you see of terrible dreams, nightmares, something that scares you is from Satan. Then he said, irrespective of the bad dreams, if you turn to your left side on your bed and you blow twice like this, then you say, I seek refuge with Allah, again is the outcast Satan. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Guess what? This bad dream should not scare you anymore because it will never happen. What about upon seeing good dreams? You can share it with your loved ones because people may envy you even for having just mere good dream. Yusuf alayhi salam, when he narrated his dream to his father, إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا والشمس والقمر رأيتهم لي ساجدين. His father, Jacob, peace be upon him, said, يا بني لا تقصص رؤياك على إخوتك فيكيدوا لك كيدا إن الشيطان للإنسان عدو مبين. So said, do not share this good dream with your brothers because normally, naturally, they didn't like him. So this is as far as good dreams and bad dreams. Good dreams are from Allah, bad dreams are from Satan. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. My dear viewers, by that we've come to the end of today's edition of Ask Huda. And until next time, we leave you all in the care of Allah. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow